God bless you. You are on tonight with Bishop Robert Johnson. Real Talk Broadcast Network. And man, we're just coming on to talk about God's Word. Talk about some things that are relative to the Bible, to God's Word. And man, we thank God for those who do tune in. And we thank God for you. And we just want to say that God is amazing and that we love you and that we're praying for everyone, especially for my sister, Angela Goff. We are praying for her and her time of need and her time of loss. Amen. We just want to give some information. I had an amazing, traumatic experience today. If you have jury summonses and you've been called to jury duty, go to court. Go to court. Trust me. Go to court. I'm going to leave it there. Amen. Serve your civic duty. Amen. Go to court. Amen. We had an amazing experience today, and we thank God. Amen. They levy fines, and those fines are serious. Even if you have proof, go to court. Amen. So we thank God for you being on tonight. Amen. With Bishop Robert Johnson and Real Talk Broadcast Network. It's amazing to be on with you again, and we thank God for you. Amen. We have some information that we want to share, and in hopes it will help you in your Christian experience with God. Amen. All right, so here we go. Amen. Tomorrow night, don't forget to tune in at 7 o'clock to the Seed Talk Show with Minister Jamal Ali and Minister Dwayne Hyler. Amen. They do an amazing job on Thursday nights. Amen. We're still getting the talk show and the time together for Sister Jane Gray. Amen. We just want to say that this is a free service, amen, and we try to make sure that we give God's word as best we can. Are we the best at it? No. Do we claim to be the best at it? No. But it's from our heart, and it's from a place that God has given and called us. God does not give everyone his will as far as certain things in ministry, but to those he does, there's an expectation for you to carry it through. So I thank God for you being on tonight. Let's go through this and let's look at some things which I believe that are critical for the body of Christ. And we want to look tonight, why was it important when Jesus made the statement in John 5:39? Jesus tells those religious leaders that you study the scripture, for in them you think you have eternal life, but these are those that testify of me. At times we take God's word and we make it applicable to us, or we make it suit us. But Jesus tells those individuals that the word of God is written of him. From Genesis to Revelations, it's about Jesus. So then, when we read Revelations 1:8, we come to the understanding that God says, through the man Jesus at that time, that I am Alpha Omega, the beginning and the end. He speaks that from a prophetic statement. Yes, he's already transitioned from death to life. Amen. But he says he's the beginning and the end. The beginning of man deals with Genesis. And we understand that Revelation is the revealed book. Amen. It reveals God's will for us. I'm not going to get into that from a theological perspective, but it reveals God's will towards man. So there's some things that we want to look at tonight and we want to share with the Bible student. We're not looking to get a million numbers, a million viewers. We're just seeking to tell the truth of God's word. It's not about me. Amen. I don't want to be anybody. I just want to tell the truth of God's word, because the Bible declares it is the word of God that will build you up and give you inheritance among those who are sanctified. Amen. The word of God has an application for everything in life if we use it. That's why I'm asking the question today. What place or what level are we in God's church, in his ministry? Are we at levels and places and positions to where we do things that are conducive for our emotions or our feelings? Or are we living the word of God based on what God said in his written word that was revealed in the man Jesus? The reason I say that, because everything that you and I can go through in life, it's found in God's word. Jesus Christ did not leave one stone unturned. That's why he said that we're built upon the apostles, the prophets, and Jesus Christ himself, the chief cornerstone. It is a reason that he did not put the prophets before the apostles, yet the prophets came first. Amen. But according to God's will and understanding, it was already in the mind that those 12 apostles, those 12 gates in the New Jerusalem, those 12 stones that are set there, were set there as a part of the foundation. Why the foundation? Because they opened the doors to the church and they gave understanding how you and I could be saved. Yet the prophets talked about it, but they moved by the Spirit of God. Amen. So let's get into this right quick. So again, why John 5:39? Because those individuals back then had what we call the Torah or the law or the Pentateuch, the first five books of Moses, the first five books of the Bible. And what they did, they looked at those things considered under Judaism or the Talmud. And what they did, they studied and they used those things. And what Jesus did before he died, he tore down the middle wall of partition, because it is the same thing that's going on today. Individuals are developing doctrines and teachings to suit themselves, to find value in themselves, opposed to the word of God. So what Jesus does, he denounces those things and let them know, even if you read it, it's about me. That's why when they tried to bring the woman to Jesus who was caught in adultery, he dealt with them the way he did, because he gave Moses the law. You say, well, how did Jesus give the law to Moses? Well, in John 1, the Bible says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Now, you say, well, that was not the man Jesus. It was the Word. Well, let's consider something. In Hebrews 10th chapter, the 7th verse, Jesus says, he states again here, some say through the writing of the Apostle Paul, he said, then said I, lo, I come in the volume of the book to do thy will, and it is written of me, O God. And if you take the same man, Jesus, according to Revelation, the 5th chapter and the 6th verse, the Bible says the 7 spirits of God were sent forth into the world. Why? To redeem you and I back to God. That's what Colossians 2:9 says, that Jesus is the head of the church. He is the firstborn of the dead. He is the fullness of the Godhead bodily. Amen. So everything that you would find, come on, Holy Ghost, Satan, you a lie in the name of Jesus. Everything that you would, I needed this, everything that you would find in God, the deity, you would find in the deity of the man Jesus, both being human and divine. The attributes of the man was to die for the sins of the world, yet he was God in human flesh. That's what the Bible says, that great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifested. In other words, he came in human flesh to redeem you and I. Well, why did he do that? If you read the Old Testament, I feel like preaching. The Bible says every time that Israel did evil in the sight of God, God had to raise someone up. But those were temporary solutions to a permanent problem, according to Hebrews, the 10th chapter. But now when it comes to Jesus, he becomes a permanent solution for a temporary problem. See how it is reversed? So when we understand Jesus did not come into the world to being priest, peace, but he came to tear Satan's kingdom down. Why? The Bible declares that Satan is the prince of this world, and Satan is not divided. His kingdom is not divided, but for some reason, the church of God is divided. So what Jesus did, he came to bring peace. He came to put us back in position to where you and I can have the favor of God reigning in our life. But isn't that like the enemy? He's still trying to throw stones like he did and convince individuals to believe outside of God. Well, if you get caught up in man, you've already lost, baby. But if you are in the word of God, you are an overcomer. That's why the Bible says that the apostles turned the world upside down through the preaching of the gospel. I need you to understand tonight, God is not doing a new thing. God is doing the same thing that was spoken in Genesis 3:15, where he talked about there would be a blood feud. It is still going on. We see an example of David suffering, but yet David was God's man. We see an example of David making mistakes, but he was a man after God's own heart. I need you to understand, child of God, God has not forsaken you. He has not forgotten you. He has not left you. Where you are right now is because he has you there. And don't come out of that place until he releases you. Don't come out of that place until he lets you go. Don't come out of that place until he changes his mind in regards to you. I need you to understand, when he writes in Jeremiah 29 and 11, God sent Israel down to Babylon for 70 years. That's why he can say, I know the thoughts that I have concerning you. He sent them to the position and to the place. Child of God, don't you know that there's no power given in regards to your life except it come from God? The devil is a lie. I need you to understand tonight, God has you right where he wants you. He has you in position and place. And when it's time, child of God, he's going to bring you out. He's going to turn your situation around. He's going to make your path clear. He's going to make your path straight. Don't let the enemy get in your mind. Don't let him pollute your soul. Don't let him pollute your spirit. But make sure that you found in the word of God. And if you have not been born again, according to John chapter 3, read it, child of God. There is a planned purpose for your life. And the reason there's a planned purpose for your life, because God wants to redeem you back to himself. Well, what are you saying, Bishop? Well, when you read all throughout the Bible, the text just represents one thing from a prophetic voice. In the Old Testament, God wrote a letter, and it was a love letter to the church. Yet it was a letter that had future tense addressed to it. It said, Jesus will do this. Future tense, but he wrote it in the prophetic so you and I could get it and read it later on, because the promises that were given to Abraham, child of God, are still for you and I today. They are yea and nay. And what you must understand, the enemy wants to remove you from where God has you. But I come to challenge you tonight. I come to talk to you tonight that can't no devil in hell pluck you out of the hand of God. I need you to understand, God is moving right now on your behalf. You need to understand, in the midst of hell, in the midst of the trial, in the midst of the situation, you better learn how to praise God. Don't praise God when things are good. Baby, you got to understand, in Exodus 1 and 12, the more that they say, the Bible says that the more Egypt begin to oppress Israel, that Israel grow. Child, your anointing should begin to grow and develop the more the devil comes against you. You should get stronger in God. You got to understand, God said, I won't leave you, neither will I forsake you, but I will be with you even to the end of the world. Child of God, that's a long time, because there is a place prepared for you and I. But the only way that we can get there, we got to be in the presence of God. If you're not in his presence now, and if things pull you out of his presence, how are you going to live with God? How are you going to be in his presence? If you can't take a little heat now in the kitchen, how are you going to deal with God? If everything offends you, if everything tees you off, if everything upsets you, how are you going to live with God in peace? Child of God, you need to touch yourself and tell yourself, I'm living for the promise. I'm living for God. I'm living for what he's about to do. I'm living for the transformation that's coming in my children's life. I'm living for the transformation that's coming in my life. I'm living for the promise. Because if God promises, child of God, it has to come to fruition. Hoo, yabba shabba. Listen, 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 listen. I need you to understand, you got to be pressed into where God is taking you. God is not going to take you in a relaxed position, child of God. Everywhere Joseph was, everywhere Jacob was, everywhere Abraham was, there was a press. Even to the point to where Abraham lied about his wife. The man who was righteous lied. Yes, he did. But God had a favor in him. God promised in him, made a promise to him. And the Bible says that against hope, Abraham believed in hope. I need you to understand, God wants your situation to be hopeless. He don't want you to know how to get out. He don't want you to know how to turn around. But he said, I'm going to bring you out with outstretched hand. He's going to bring you out on eagle's wings. You need to understand, God has already saw your destiny before you got there. Your future has already been determined. But I need you to understand, God said, I'm with you, child of God. That's why I like what God said in Isaiah. Though you go through the fire, I'll be with you. The Bible said God is a consuming fire. You put me in the fire. You talk about me. You're talking about God. Why? Because God is connected to me through his spirit. Ooh, Hayabusha. Listen. Let me move on. I got it anointed. I had to go get by myself and have a Minister Bogan experience. I had to go to the park and stretch out on my face and say, God, I need you. God said, son, I'm about to anoint you greater than I have ever called you. God, for all the affliction, son, for all the affliction, for all the lies, for all the persecution, I'm about to take you to another level. Child of God, don't run from the pain. Run into the pain, because pain produces power. You got to understand God is calling you in this hour. And because he's calling you, he's already made provisions, and provision provide protection. Why? Because of his planned purpose for your life. I'm done. God is looking for those who will be faithful unto death. And if you're faithful, he said, I'll make you ruler over many. He can't give you what you desire because you're not faithful. But when you find faithfulness, God will find you. When you turn your heart around, God will turn towards you. When you stop rejecting his word, he'll stop rejecting you. Whew. God bless you on tonight. I thank God for you. Some things you need, child of God. Stop running from the pain and run into it, knowing that God is there for you. And if you run into it, God got you. God bless you. This has been Bishop Robert Johnson, Real Talk, Broadcast Network. God bless you. We love you very much.